We can get started. Thank you everybody for joining us. If you don't know me already, I'm John White. I'm the Transitions of Care Coordinator at the Arkansas Department of Health. And today we have a webinar that is going to be very focused for your abstraction and running report needs. It's really made for your coordinators and your registrars. I think you're going to find it very interesting. I've got a couple of housekeeping things on the screen right now. Hopefully you see a QR code, right, and a link. I dropped that link in the chat. Register your attendance. When I go to send out evals for the course and later for CMEs, that's the roster that I'm going to go off and send evals to. So make sure that you get yourself registered. If not, I'm going to be on after we're done. If you're on the phone and you're not on a computer, just stay on. And then when everybody's done, speak up and let me know that you're here, and I'll register you for I'll register for you. A little bit of housekeeping here. UAMS makes me show these slides. So it's the UAMS disclosure policy. Basically, we're working to ensure a balanced, independent, objective opportunity today. So here's the disclosure screen. None of us have any disclosures. I wish I did, but I don't. And here's some joint accreditation statements. I'll let you read them real quick. I'm not going to read them to you. One more. We'll have 1 hour of ANCC credit today. If we happen, I don't think that we have anybody that's EMS today. If you do though, I can get you credit through the section of EMS for 1 hour. So perfect. All right. And I'm going to introduce our speakers in the order that they're going to in the order that they're going to appear for us today. First, we're going to have Ms. Nancy Cole. She is the manager of data abstraction services at American Data Network. In her role, she oversees a team of 50 members across the United States, ensuring high standards in healthcare data quality. There we go. With 15 years of experience in healthcare quality, Nancy brings extensive expertise to her position. She holds a master's degree in healthcare administration and CPHQ credentials. She's an active member of both the Arkansas Association of Healthcare Quality and National Association of Healthcare Quality. Welcome with us today, Nancy. And then following Nancy, I've got Mary Jo Simica from American Heart. She's a program consultant with healthcare quality. Her primary focus is stroke, and she serves Arkansas, Colorado, New Mexico, Oklahoma, and Wyoming. She lives in Little Rock. Before joining AHA, she served as the quality improvement manager at the Arkansas Department of Health, and prior to that, program administrator of education and quality initiatives at the University of Arkansas for Medical Sciences. There she worked on maintenance of certificate initiatives, and she also has a master's in public administration, master's in international human rights law, and is a certified professional in healthcare quality. So thank you so much, ladies, for being with us today. Nancy, I'm going to turn it over to you to start, and you can share your screen and we'll get going.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. And it is so nice to see all of your lovely faces or names today. I've met a lot of you. I've talked a lot with a lot of you via email, but it's always nice, Kara. I've never seen your face. I know we've talked all the time in email, and the same for Cynthia as well. Like Jonathan said, my name is Nancy Cole. I am the manager of data abstraction services here at American Data Network. And welcome to today's webinar on understanding and improving EHR data quality. Today, I'm going to discuss with you some key issues, best practices, and reliability assessments related to EHR data, specifically for stroke. Additionally, Mary Jo, who will go after me, will discuss the Get With The Guideline Stroke program, Get With The Guideline Stroke, the data tool reports, all of those things. My portion of the webinar, I'm going to cover an overview of common EHR issues, a discussion I'll get with about on stroke abstractions and the partnership between the Arkansas Department of Health and American Data Network, insights and best practices for data entry, and the importance of inter-rater reliability assessments. So ADM works closely with the Arkansas Department of Health on the Arkansas Stroke Registry to provide abstraction and or reabstraction to meet the primary goal of 100% of all facilities in the state participating in the stroke registry by entering stroke data to improve stroke-driven care in Arkansas. And as all of us are gathered here today, we all have a common goal to increase our stroke compliance scores, right? So not only does ADN assist the stroke registry participants with data entry, ADN also assists many hospitals across the United States with their healthcare quality improvement efforts. I am the manager of the data abstraction services line here at ADN, and I also serve as the liaison between ADN abstraction team members as well as ADH contacts. Many of you have emailed me, sent me your patient list, talked about how to obtain access, whatever it is that your facility needs, you probably talked to me. And if not, hello. We also have two assistant managers who you may see their names coming up here shortly in email, Tammy Holton and Crystal Hout. And as well, we have a director of data abstraction services, and her name is Delana Pittman. This data abstraction services service line has 51 team members that span across 14 states with an average of 21 years of healthcare experience between bedside nursing and healthcare quality or quality improvement efforts. So even if you needed someone to assist you with the data entry, and many of you have heard me say this, I have the resources available. The education across our service line includes master's degrees, which includes several advanced practice nurses, and most of our team members hold a bachelor or an associate's degree, and many of those bachelor's and associate degrees are nursing degrees. So here are some of the EHR data issues that are frequently encountered when completing chart abstractions. And while many of these may not apply to your facility, I want to bring them up because we've seen these types of issues in the past for many of our clients. So first one is data entry errors, such as erroneous dates and times or mistyped stroke band IDs. Sometimes when those stroke ID bands are typed in, it's missing one or two numbers. We know that the stroke band ID is an S followed by a string of numbers. And we found that sometimes, you know, Karen may reach out and say, hey, this person had a stroke band ID applied. And well, it's missing a number and we can't enter it. So we have to have that entire stroke band ID number to enter it. Another one is erroneous dates and times. We find that often just by miskey of the nurse or whoever's entering that data in the EMR. Second one is data completeness issues like missing data or incomplete patient records. An example of that is the AR saves consult is not scanned into the chart in a particular location. So the abstraction team can't see that and can't use it unless we can lay our eyes on it. Another issue that we've encountered is not receiving the entire patient record, which causes the ADN abstractor to have to mark the chart as incomplete in the registry. Data standardization problems, such as variations in terminology or missing documentation or a lack of standardized templates and forms. An example of that is no discrete location for your dysphagia screening in the chart. You may find it here. You may find it here. Sometimes it's free text. That has been a challenge recently. And then system issues such as software glitches or integration challenges. So we've had some issues with software certificates expiring recently, which causes our abstraction team to not be able to remote into your EMR. We've had difficulty in obtaining access from the facility IT department, or a big one that has come up is ADN abstraction team members not having the same view of the EMR as someone in the facility. So, for example, Cynthia is in the facility at Northwest Health. I can't remember which facility Cynthia, sorry, but she has access to her EMR and then ours looks much different from her. And she's like, hey, I can find the stroke band ID. I can find the dysphagia screening. I can find the NIST score. And then when we compare screens, we find out that we don't have the same view of the EMR as someone in the facility. So that has been quite a challenge recently and frequently encountered. The Arkansas Stroke Registry, as many of you participate in the Arkansas Stroke Registry, is a collaboration between the Arkansas Department of Health and the American Heart or American Stroke Associations. And as I said earlier, ADM works closely with the ADH on the Arkansas Stroke Registry. The goal is to collect real-time data on stroke treatment from our hospitals serving Arkansas. And using this data, the Arkansas Stroke Registry strives to accomplish optimizing the quality of stroke care of all Arkansans, decreasing death and disability associated with acute stroke, reduce disparities in stroke patient care, and increase public awareness of stroke treatment and prevention. As I've stated, ADH uses the IQVIA platform to aggregate the data for the Arkansas Stroke Registry, as many of you all are familiar with, and Mary Jo will go over that shortly. And the goal is to have 100% of all facilities in the state participate in the stroke registry and enter stroke data to improve stroke-driven care within our state. And I am proud to say that we are getting there almost. So there are benefits to outsourcing. Many of your names I do recognize, and we and ADN does complete your chart abstractions for you. But for those of you who do not outsource your data or your data abstraction to ADN, there are some benefits to outsourcing. Number one is improving your business focus. So management of abstraction is time consuming. Combing through charts is time consuming. That time and energy can be refocused on goals, such as achieving status or increasing a rate of a specific measure. So instead of you doing the tedious work of entering that data, then you can run the reports that Mary Jo will go over later. And then you can say, hey, we're about 0.5 or we're 5/10 of a point away, or we're 2 points away from meeting this goal to have defect-free care, to have perfect care, or achieve a gold status or a silver status or a bronze status with the Gamma Stroke. It also allows you to refocus resources. You can focus on your process improvement strategies to increase compliance with your standards of care instead of the tediousness of data abstraction. And you can also move your staff to positions to monitor improvement initiatives. It also helps to increase agility and flexibility, increase confidence in the data and confidence and accuracy of the data from a neutral party, because we don't have a relationship with your physicians at the facility or any nurses. So we're coming in with an unbiased approach and saying, hey, well, this physician didn't document this. And there's no way for us to say, well, we know what Dr. ABC was thinking. We know that he meant this. That removed data abstraction and outsourcing it removes that bias from that. And then it also allows you to prepare for future challenges. So any operational or financial threats, staff and turnover position or position turnovers. In that way, if you outsource your data abstraction, your data collection still occurs and provides any insight that you may need to report to your upper leadership. So here are some best practices for data entry. The first one that I can come up with is creating documentation tendency templates. As we know, Get With The Guideline Stroke has a lot of data points, quite a bit of data points. And sometimes those data points can live all across your EMR. Create a documentation tendencies template using an Excel spreadsheet or a Word document. And it can be something very simple that says, we always find the last known well here. We always find the dysphagia screening here. Here's where the earliest arrival time is, because sometimes you have a triage time, you have an arrival time. Sometimes, depending on how the patient came into the hospital, determines which one is the earliest. Some EMRs have multiple arrival times documented. So that helps to outline where it makes creates consistency and where you find the data in your EMR. Enter your data regularly. So this ensures that you stay up to date with the registry and you don't fall behind. That outsourcing that I talked about earlier of the data entry allows you to focus on your process improvement. Review your reports monthly and share any lessons learned with key individuals in your hospital. So that way you can determine what's working and what's not working and what you can change and what you can measure and see if you hit the mark or hit the goals that you've set for your organization. Implement that process improvement so that you can measure if current methods are working. And remember that process improvement is a marathon and not a sprint. I know we live in a world of instant gratification, but it takes time to make some significant changes in your organization when it comes to changing data or process improvement. And then create action plans. Identify what additional resources that you need. Like, do you need additional abstractors? Do you need additional assistance? Do you need to outsource? Those types of things. So create an action plan to help you outline where you need to go next. There are ways to improve data entry as well. So the first one is consistency is key. Work with key people in your organization if they're available to improve documentation as well as final coding for stroke patients. So some of these key people in your organization look like your informatics department if you have one, your coding department or your coders, and even your nursing leadership. Enter your data timely and consistently because that helps you to make sure that you create an action plan and follow up with it. And focus on your improvement in bite sizes. And please do not try to do everything at once because we want no one overwhelmed, okay? You can create and design order sets or templates or flow sheets to place in your patient records to help capture the information more systematically and consistently. You can make sure that they're triggered based on your ED physician's diagnosis. So, for example, if your ED physician says ischemic stroke, then you can kind of trigger what needs to happen next. So, for example, one of the failures that we see or fallouts that we see often is a dysphagia screen. Best practice that we've seen across the state is a lot of people are screening for dysphagia by a simple swallowing assessment as soon as that patient is triaged. And that has helped to decrease the dysphagia screen fallout. So that's a good idea of how you can implement things in your order set or your workflow for your ED or wherever the patient comes in. Consider the time frames for many of the measures. So some things can be done in the ED, some things can be done on discharge. Determine where those can best be done and create a plan to help you meet those. Review those measure specifications and definitions so that ensures that you understand what each measure is actually measuring. And share any lessons learned, in which this is a best practice for entry and a way to improve data entry. It helps you to understand what's working, what's not working, what additional resources are needed, and identify areas of improvement with key stakeholders in your organization. Reach out to colleagues in the healthcare world. All of us have a common goal here. All of us work in healthcare. We all know that some of our hospitals compete with other hospitals, but if we're going to improve the stroke care in the state of Arkansas, we have to work better and share lessons learned. Many of you use the same EMR across the board. It may be a good idea to say, hey, we started documenting this here and it helped us increase our compliance at North Arkansas, but and it may also help a Northwest Health System as well. So integrated reliability. So IRR or integrated reliability is the process of a one-to-one comparison of a case or a data element to data element comparison of abstracted data to ensure consistency of the data entry between the original abstractor and the re-abstractor. IRR is a learning process and not a punitive process for the original abstractor. And a score is calculated based on the number of paired data elements with matches, and a percentage score is calculated. So IRR ensures that your data is accurate, and we all know how important accurate data is to the stakeholders of the organization. IRR also builds trust in the data quality as well. So completing IRR will allow you to focus in on your educational efforts for that abstractor and also your abstraction team when it comes to understanding the coding instructions for the registry. And it allows you to share any educational lessons learned with that. So ADN does do IRR. We do IRR on our own abstractors, and many of you also participated in the IRR process as being the only abstractor at your facility because we've handled it for the Arkansas Department of Health before. That IRR process allows, because everybody sometimes misinterprets or interprets things differently, and it allows you to open up your eyes to something different, which is why I say that's an educational process or educational opportunity for everyone involved. So, as I said, IRR results can be used to ensure that you have accurate data and build trust in your data quality if you're having someone else do that IRR or do the original abstractions at your organization. And then you should implement IRR at your organization some way, somehow, especially for stroke. So that looks like establishing a timeline, identifying the IRR abstractor for your data, and providing feedback and continuous improvement. So when you think about implementing an IRR routine at your facility, determine the timeline. I do recommend at least quarterly IRR is completed with your dedicated IRR buddy or a re-abstractor, and pick someone that you trust and someone that's not going to fluff you up. So pick someone that you know that's going to tell you the truth and say, hey, you actually missed this, and I found it here, and here's why I chose this over this, and give you some reasoning behind it. If you don't have a dedicated IRR buddy at your facility, consider outsourcing to the experts. And ADN is happy to take that burden off of you and handle that for you and provide feedback. When determining or implementing IRR at your organization, a question that comes up all the time is, how many cases should you choose to have IRR to re-abstract it? Choose a percentage of those cases that's a true representative of the volume of your cases for the quarter. So if you're going to do quarterly IRR and you have 50 cases, you choose what's the number that is best to have IRR. Experts typically say 3 to 5%, but 3 to 5% for larger hospitals looks much, is a larger sample of cases in a smaller hospital. So if you need any assistance with determining that, please let me know. As I said, many of you partner with ADN for chart abstraction as a participant in Arkansas Stroke Registry, but if not, there are steps. It's a relatively simple process, so let's just explore those steps. So first things first, we need to get a BAA, and that's a business associate's agreement, and we have to have that on file before we start access to your EMR, access to IQVIA, any of that. And that can be obtained from your hospital's business office or your HIM department. And then after we get that BAA, then we can move to system access. And so any HIPAA or confidentiality agreements that need to be signed will need to be sent to me, and I will disperse those to our abstraction team members for completion. And then we'll send those back to your IT department to process and gain remote access to your EMR. Typically, once we receive a patient list, ADN does complete patient list within 30 days of the receipt of the patient list. So for example, if you send us the patient list today on June the 6th, ADN will have it complete on or before July the 6th. That ensures that you stay up to date in the registry. You have real-time data to drive decisions and do any process improvement that you need to do. And then we do recommend that you review any fallout. One of the challenges that I discussed earlier is sometimes we don't have the same view of EMR that you do. So we may miss things because we're all human. And especially if it's an EMR that we have not had experience with, we may miss something, and we want to have the opportunity to review the case and make any updates to the record. We have even found, and I'm going to point Cynthia out here because I'm looking at her, but and Cynthia works in Northwest Health. Northwest Health, we abstract for three of their facilities, and each one of them have different documentation tendencies, and two of them use the same EMR. So Hospital A, Hospital B can be right across your street from each other on the same street. You can walk out of one door into the next one, and they have different documentation tendencies because the staff is different. And then if you participate in the Arkansas Stroke Registry and ADN does your original abstraction, sorry, ADN does handle the re-abstraction components for you on behalf of that. Even if you wanted ADN, if we did not do your ongoing abstractions on a monthly basis for you and you wanted ADN to do the IRR or the re-abstraction component, please let me know because we're happy to do that and provide you some educational feedback as well. So always tell people this is my favorite quote. ADN CEO said this to us in a meeting before, but with a little extra time, you can raise the standard from good enough to great. So if you just spend a little time working on your stroke metrics to improve the care of stroke and your scores at your facility, you can move that standard from good enough to great. So I'm going to turn it over to Mary Jo. But if any of you need assistance with chart abstraction, because ADN does not do it, or you would like for us to do the IRR component of that for you and provide you some educational feedback, please reach out to me. All right, Mary Jo, it is your turn.
All right. Thank you, Nancy. It's always nice to be on a call with you. Thank you, Jonathan, for inviting me. I always enjoy talking about. I always enjoy talking about Git with a guideline stroke, and particularly today, talking about how to run reports to do data analysis. And so, let's. All right, are you seeing my screen? I am going to.
Yes, I can see it.
All right. Okay. So we're going to talk about Git with a guideline stroke and how to use the data to improve the quality of your care. You will know, being a user of Git with a guideline stroke, that we're all about adhering to the latest scientific guidelines. And the data has proven that by doing so, we improve stroke outcomes. And by collecting and analyzing the data, we can maximize effectiveness. I'm not going to go through all of these points of the process. So this is really the process of kind of how does the science get in to get with the guidelines? And how does that then create, how does that impact the way we do our care? So we're not going to go through all of that, but it's really more of a circular kind of process. You know, our experts are always looking at the data, looking at the research, looking at publications. And then if it warrants, we either issue new guidelines or update existing guidelines. And those guidelines then get developed into specific measures you will then see and get with the guideline stroke. You enter the data and then you analyze that data to see to what extent the care you're giving is in adherence to the guidelines. And if not, you have the opportunity to really dig deeper into that data to do some quality improvement. So the process continues to go around continuously, but I'm going to focus here on data analysis and quality improvement. So I'm going to just kind of give you a little example about how to do this process. How do you look at your data and determine where your patient fallouts are, and then how do you take that information into identifying quality improvement? So I'm going to start out by just showing you generally how to do that, and then we're going to look at some specific measures. I have quite a few slides, so Jonathan, please don't hesitate to just cut me off at any point. You say, "Look, you've had enough," so I won't take offense. So let's go up. So it really is kind of a 7-step process. And we're going to go through each of those 7 steps. So you really need to know what patients are included or excluded from your data. And you do that by looking at the measure descriptions. The measure descriptions are in the library under reports. The measures are in different kind of categories. So, you know, achievement measure will be in that achievement measure grouping. So there are different groups, but the measure descriptions are in the library. So you're going to start out with that. So this is what you're going to end up finding. It's going to look like this. Your measure description is going to look very similar to this. Some are more extensive. So in this column here, it's kind of a text. And here are the exact elements from Git with the guidelines that are being used for this. So in this case, this is pre-notification by EMS. So the initial patient population are all those patients who initially are going to be looked at for this particular measure. It indicates here that it's all patients who are over 18. I mean, you shouldn't be entering anybody under 18 anyway and get with a guideline stroke, but nonetheless, that's there. And then it's those patients who have these particular stroke diagnoses. So that is your kind of initial pot of patients. You're then going to go to the denominator, and the denominator may be exactly the same as the initial patient population. In some cases, though, it continues to narrow that pool a little bit. So in this case, it's all the patients who were in the initial patient population, but who were transported to your hospital by EMS. So that's a narrowing of the population that is in this particular pool. Exclusions may narrow that pool even further. You will see in almost all of the measures that if the patient is enrolled in a clinical trial, that they will be excluded from that patient pool. And if they're therefore elective carotid intervention, they will also be removed from that patient pool. But in some cases, you're going to see a much longer list. But again, it's a narrowing of your data pool. And then finally, exceptions. Now, exceptions are an exception is really where a patient it should have received a particular intervention, but there are specific reasons why that would be inappropriate. So you will remember, if you're familiar with the data extraction for IV thrombolytics, arrive by 3.5, treat by 4.5, that particular measure. There's an opportunity in there for you to indicate that even though they arrived within that time window, it would be inappropriate to give them IV thrombolytics, and it asks you to identify the specific reasons why. So that would be an exception. So somebody who would, it would be expected that they would receive a particular intervention, but it was determined that that would be inappropriate. So then they are also taken out of that data pool. So now that takes you to your final kind of list of patients for this particular measure. Your numerator are the patients or that actually did receive that intervention. So the denominator, after it's been filtered down, are those patients who should receive something? The numerator are those who actually did. You want those two numbers to be as close as possible, right? Everybody who should get this did. If the numerator is smaller than the denominator, then those are your fallouts. Those are patients who should have received something and who did not. It can also be more of a process. It could be like the measure could be on dysphagia screening. Was a dysphagia screening conducted? These are the patients for whom it should have been. These are the ones who actually did. So the numerator and the denominator are what you are looking at, and you ideally would like to see them be the same. This is another example. Again, this is your initial patient population. The denominator, there's no addition, there's no further filtering, so it's the same as the initial patient population. But then you're going to see quite a few more exclusions in this example. Patients who are not admitted, then they will be taken out of that data pool. People who were discharged or transferred to hospice or acute care facility, they're going to be taken out of the data pool. And then an exception. This particular example is patients who received antithrombotic therapy at discharge, and there can be a reason why it would be inappropriate to do that. So that would be your exception. So that's your final data pool, and your numerator are those patients for whom who actually did have an antithrombotic medication prescribed at discharge. So that's your denominator and your numerator, and those patients who didn't receive it are your fallouts. So that is generally how you're going to use your measure descriptions so that you understand what patients are included or excluded from a measure. So it's always good to familiarize yourself with that before you kind of start to dig deeper. So now that you understand the measure description, you're going to want to run a report to look at the performance on whatever measures you want to look at. And there are guidelines in Get With the Guideline Stroke in the library about exactly how to run reports. So when you go to run a report, you're gonna find this in your configurable measures report. You're gonna pick your time frame. You're gonna pick your measures. You can pick one measure. You can pick a whole measure bundle. You can pick measures from different bundles. You can then benchmark it. Either you can run it just for your own hospital. You can benchmark it with other benchmarks for the entire state of Arkansas. Whatever you want to do, this measures report is your default. So you don't need to do anything with that at this point. So at this point, we're simply looking at our measures to see how we are performing on whatever measures you want to have a look at. So this is an example of what you might see when you have applied your parameters. You've selected your measures. So this is something, this might be something you're going to see. In this example, more than one measure has been selected to look at. And if you select more than one and they are the same kind of measure, so it would be logical that they could be on the same kind of screen, you would want to pick here under display options. You can pick graph similar measures and they'll all be on the same screen. If you have picked different kinds of measures that cannot be on the same type of graph, you will see different tabs down here at the bottom. And also, then finally, we're going to talk about filters in a minute. If you want to look at a measure and you want to compare it between males and females, you want to filter it by sex. Maybe you want to filter it by race. So you want to be able to compare results. Then this is where you're going to find that information. If you have selected it, I'm going to show you in a minute how to select it. But if you have, and then you run your report, you're going to want to pick the drop-down arrow right here under comparison variables. And then that's where you will have the opportunity to select those different filters that you have applied. So these are all, this is demo data. This is not real data. But say we run something like this and we know what report we want to look deeper in because our performance is below what we want. This is the first step. So now I know how I'm performing and I can identify what measures I want to look a bit deeper into. So that's the next step of the process. We're going to do a patient record report to look at every patient in that measure and to see, to have us be able to start to dig down deeper into that data. So you are going to do the same kind of thing you did on the configure a measure report. You picked your time frame, you're picking your measures. You cannot benchmark when you are looking into specific patient data. You can't benchmark against other hospitals or, because you don't have access to patient level data. So the benchmarks is grayed out. But then you're going to up here, where, as I said, measure report was the default. When I want to look at patient records, I am going to select this option because that will give me the opportunity to look at patients. So I picked my measure, my time frame, and I've selected that. Now, this is an example of what you might see when you have done that. This is only for one measure. This is just an example of NIH, a stroke scale reported. Now, if you want to just look at your fallouts, so a fallout is somebody who is in the denominator but is not in the numerator, you can select right here. You can just look at who you want to look at. So I can say, I just want to look at those who are in the denominator but are not in the numerator. So yes and no here. This is just going to show me my fallouts. It can just help kind of get everybody else off the screen, if that's really what you want to look at. So this is NIHSS reported. Often for a measure, you will see one or two elements that really initially capture that data, right? So this is for NIH reported. This is the element right here. Is there documentation that an initial NIH stroke scale score was done? And you can see all of these blanks. So you can understand that that's why many of these patients are failing that measure because that element is not answered. So you can immediately see all of these blanks. So that gives you a clue that, that is probably where my problem lies. So the first thing you're going to want to do is make sure the abstraction is accurate. So, you're going to want to go back to your electronic health record, make sure that data genuinely is not in there, so that the abstraction is accurate. If it is in there, maybe it was in a place that you didn't expect. Nancy already talked about different providers do it different ways. You can make the changes yourself. So, you go in there, make the changes, because you want your data to be as accurate as possible. So it could be an abstraction problem that the data was in the record, it just wasn't abstracted, or it could be that it's not in the record and that you have a documentation issue with your providers. But this is the first thing if you see all these blanks, you want to make sure that the abstraction is accurate. So if I've done that, I now need to try to understand what might be the reason for any particular fallout. Obviously, if the data is not there, then I know that can be corrected. But perhaps why isn't it there? What might be a reason why the data is not being put in, why it's maybe not being put in properly? So you start to think about what might be key indicators of variables about where these problems are taking place. You will know probably that there are a lot of categories within Get With the Guidelines Stroke for different providers. So maybe you want to do, this is NIH reported, maybe you want to put it in admitting physician and you want to filter it that way. Maybe that's going to tell you something. This is a screenshot of a data download report. It enables you to do a lot more variables at one time. I'm not going to go to the data download report. It's a lot more, it requires more time than what we have. There are instructions in the library about how to do a data download report, but you just might like to do that simply because you can add a lot more variables at one time. You can, when you're doing a simple filter, you can add a few more filters here, but you cannot do a standard and a multi-select at the same time. So you are a little bit limited in what you can examine. But this is then how you're going to go. You're going to want to add filters to try to identify trends. So we're going to look at some examples about how to use this process. But finally, when you've got some ideas about maybe what the problems are, you're going to want to do some kind of quality improvement, process improvement. So it's important that you know your data. You have to understand your data, and you want to be have that data be as timely as possible so that you are on top of your data, very regularly. It's very difficult if you're only looking at your data like every 3 months and you found a problem that's been going on for 3 months, providers haven't been doing something, they've been documented incorrectly. That's very hard. That takes a long time to perhaps kind of re-educate your providers and to start see them doing it correctly. So really try to be on top of your data and do your reviews as often as you can, certainly as close to the incident as possible. When you're doing quality improvement, it can help to involve other people. If you have a quality department, involve your quality people. Just involve other people who might be able to help you change behaviors if that's the case. You're going to find that you're going to need to re-educate your providers probably pretty regularly. If it's a documentation problem, if they're not doing something, they're not documenting it, you're going to want to re-educate. You're probably going to find the need to do a lot of re-education. It's also important to praise and acknowledge good work. I know many stroke coordinators have talked to me about, they'll say when they go to talk to the nurses are like, oh no, but what have I done wrong? But to also really recognize when people are doing it right. That's really important for you to be able to build your relationship with your providers, so that you're going to have a better opportunity, to get some better results. And within Get With the Guidelines, because you can run data even down from to a daily level, if you do some kind of intervention, maybe you've done some re-education, whatever it is that you've undertaken to try to reduce your fallouts on a particular measure, you can take note of when you started to do that. And you can look at your data after that. You can compare before intervention and after interventions to really see to what extent the performance has changed. So the Get With the Guidelines is really considered, it is much more than just data collection. It really is an important quality improvement tool. So let's just go through a few. I have a number on here, but we can just do as few as need be. So this is real data now that we are actually looking for the state of Arkansas. The first one is pre-notification. So we're going to look at the measure description. So this is the measure description for pre-notification. We already kind of looked at that when we were doing examples. So this is where you're going to find the pre-notification. It's in the reporting measures bundle on your configurable reports page. And this is the data. This is the real data for pre-notification in Arkansas for the last 4 years. So you can see that since 2020, the rate of pre-notification by EMS has been going up. And that's quite good. But we still have 23% of patients for whom there isn't a pre-notification. And remember, this is pre-notification patients who came by EMS. So, but you can see the results are improving, and that's what we always like to see. So if you think about, okay, so this is a relatively simple measure. So this is pre-notification by EMS. So the most likely filter you might want to apply is EMS agency. If you want to look at the results, pre-notification by EMS agency, that seems to be the most logical kind of filter to use. And when you do that, again, this is demo data, this is not real data, then you will get a list of your EMS agencies, and then you can see to the extent to which they did or did not give you pre-notification. So that right there is going to be help guide you on what agencies are less likely to do pre-notification, and for you to start having conversations with them about how you can improve that. So this one is pre-notifications are a relatively straightforward measure. Stroke band ID documented. This is your measure description. So you're going to want to do this first so you kind of understand who, what patients are in or are not in that measure. Stroke band documented again is here under reporting measures in your configurable reports. And these are the actual results for stroke band documented for the last 4 years. Again, you can see that the rate has been going up for the last 4 years, and that's good. 78% have stroke band documented, only 22% do not. So that's good, but it still means 22% do not. And the results may be different in your particular facility. So, what might you want to look at? So if a stroke band ID isn't documented, where do you think maybe the problem is? Where do you think there's some kind of barrier to that being done? Again, maybe you want to look at providers. Maybe that's going to give you some kind of clue. I'm not going to share the results on that. Again, it's demo data, but maybe that's going to give you a clue. And you can do a list. It will show you the actual providers, was there a document stroke band documented or not? And you can maybe see a trend. Well, this provider that really has a high rate of not documenting stroke band. That might give you kind of a clue where you want to go. But you can choose other filters. You'll be surprised, you may be surprised if you put in like arrival day. You'll be surprised at how often you see variances on many measures by the day of the week that they arrive. Very interesting. It could be you want to look filter it by sex or race or any other variable to really try to figure out, see where is there a trend. I picked one where I thought, well, let's look at this. Let's look at the difference between the arrival day and their last known well. Is there a difference between patients who come quite soon after their stroke or a difference if they came quite a ways after? Let's look and see if that tells me anything. And in fact, it did. So these are patients who arrive within 2 hours of last known well. And you can see just under 15% stroke band are not documented for those patients. But if you look here at patients who arrive over 24 hours after they had their stroke, it's nearly double in terms of not being documented. So why is that? What's happening? That means we're more likely to not document a stroke band ID if they come later after their last known well. That's for you then to look at what are we doing differently for those patients. So it's this kind of filtering that you can use to really give you a clue as to where the problems might be, and then for you to kind of take that and look at doing some quality improvement. Door to CT. This is your measure description. You're going to find that under the reporting measures. This is the actual data for door to CT for Arkansas, door to CT less than 25 minutes. You can see again, the rate is going up, and that's great, but it's still only 58%. So we still have a good percentage of patients for whom we're not getting door to CT within 25 minutes. So again, what do you think might be impacting your door to CT time? Why do you think it might be varying? How about how patient arrived at my hospital? Let's look at that. And in fact, you can see that here. That in fact shows you, at least at the state level, that it's much more likely for a patient to get door to CT less than 25 minutes if they came by EMS. If they came by private transport or transfer from another hospital, you could see the rate is much lower. So again, you start to think about what's happening at my hospital so that I can do the door to CT quicker for EMS patients. And is there some way I can make a change for the processes we have so that even a private arrival will have a much higher rate of door to CT time? So, that's kind of that's the way you do your data review. IV thrombolytics within 4.5 is much more complicated. So I think I probably won't go into full detail about that. You do probably you may know that there are two time frames within that measure. There's zero if they arrive within 0 to 3 hours of last known well, or 3 to 4.5. So if they arrive within that window, if they arrive within 3.5, within 3 hours of last known well, then it is expected that they will get IV thrombolytics. So you have to, it has to be documented. Why not? We didn't give it within that time. This are the reason, these are the specific reasons why. So it is more complicated because you have the two time frames and you have to documented reasons why not for both of those time frames. But it's in the slide, so I'll kind of leave that to you. And then finally, defect-free care. Defect-free care is actually under the defect-free measures grouping within configurable reports. Defect-free care, Coverdell defect-free care. Again, the results are going up every year, so that's something to be proud of. Defect-free care again is more complicated because it is made up of 13 different variables. So if your defect-free care is quite low, you're going to have to run a report on all of those 13, or at least most of them, to try to figure out which one am I really falling down on. So it takes a little bit more time, but you can pick a whole bundle and run a whole bundle at one time so you can see all the results. But that will give you a clue because there are 13 measures in there, which ones am I really falling down on? And that's just the process that you will go through to identify your fallouts and to try to do some kind of quality improvement around identifying what the reasons are and what kind of remedies might help you get your compliance rate up. Know your data. Again, this is just what we talked about before. Just you need to know your data and you need to kind of be on top of it, because again, if you don't find out till 3 months later, it is hard for you to get your performance up for the year. Possibly if you don't discover it till October or something, then it can be hard for you to really get the improvement that you need. So, try to be on top of your data as quickly as possible and do the kind of quality improvement that I mentioned. And just the key points, respond to your data as quickly as you can. It's important to have timely abstractions so that you're looking at your data as close to real time as possible. Do your performance reviews regularly so that you always are making sure you're on top of it, and dig deeper to find out what's going on. What is it that, why am I having fallouts here, and what can I do to improve it? Initiate quality improvement initiatives with your quality staff, with your other staff, and monitor it so that you can see how effective that particular intervention has been. So I hope this has been helpful for you to understand how to analyze your data. If you have any questions, if you want any help, don't hesitate to contact me. And I'd be happy we can meet and we can go through some of your data. I do really enjoy doing data reviews with you. So if you really would like to do that, I'm more than happy to do that. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer. Otherwise, I think Jonathan, you're going to have to kick me out. So because Stop sharing my slides.
I'm working on it. Here we go.
Don't worry.
My computer's just kind of slow to respond. Well, thanks so much, guys. Do we have any questions? You can feel free to just speak up, or you can put them in the chat. And I'm gonna say while y'all are thinking about it, make sure that you registered your attendance. I went and looked at my form, and I've got I think 18 folks registered, and I've only got and we've got 30 people on the call. So let me know. Let me know by following that link that you're here. Well, while you're thinking about that, and while I have you as a captive audience, I also want to pick your brain. So I'm starting to think about the next year coming up. Well, first of all, thank you, Mary Jo, and thank you, Nancy, for being with us today and having such great material prepared for us about using the registry, getting things out of the registry. I love it. It's good stuff. I will have this online hopefully soon. So if you know folks that didn't get to join us, I'll get that posted out somewhere on the internet. And also, like I said, wanted to pick your brain. I'm thinking about what to do for next year. If you have ideas for things that you'd like to see, let me know. Let me know what you might like to see. The world is our oyster. I can do, whatever I want with our webinar. So let me know what you think. Hopefully you see this QR code. If you're having trouble registering and you need my help, just stay on and speak up and let me know, and I'll get you entered. But otherwise, I'll be looking for an eval from me here this afternoon or maybe tomorrow morning. And
Hey, John,
yes.
you've got a couple of questions in the chat.
Oh,
Yeah,
great.
there's two. One is from Kelsey. Looks like I'm gonna answer that one. I was gonna say the other one's from Mary Jo about running reports on custom. Kelsey, that one about the patient fall with a head injury and the diagnosis was the SAH, the trauma band was placed, and you was told you needed a stroke band ID instead. Is this right? So that's one of those gray areas because sometimes you never know if the fall is a mechanical fall. I think that's what it's called, and I'm not a nurse, but I've seen a lot of charts over the years. Sometimes that easily can cross into two. It can be a trauma activation and it can be a stroke. I would err on the side of caution and put a stroke band ID on that patient too, and then you're covered. And also work with your coding department and your ED physicians to kind of streamline your documentation too. I hope that's helpful.
Yes, it is. Thank you very much.
I had a quick question kind of related to that. If the patient, is there still a rule, or I may have just heard it through the grapevine, that if a patient is in the stroke registry or the, or vice versa, if the patient is in the trauma registry, it does not go in the stroke registry. How do you
I
guys
have
think heard
never
that?
heard that. I have not ever heard that, but we've always entered. If the patient has a principal diagnosis code of a stroke, ischemic, hemorrhagic, whatever, we've always entered it into the stroke registry. But I'm not, because we ABN does abstract trauma, but we don't abstract trauma as a partnership with the Department of Health. So I'm not sure about that specific rule, if that's written somewhere in the trauma guidelines.
Yeah, it
Oh,
really
I don't know
depends
that
on
for sure.
final clinical diagnosis of stroke. If that is the case, then it goes into the stroke registry. If it is a trauma, then it won't go into the registry. So again, it's really just the final clinical diagnosis.
Okay, and I know a lot of ours too is like they have a fall, and some of the subarachnoids they still transfer out through TraumaCom, and if they're transferred through TraumaCom, then it has to go in the trauma registry as well. So that's kind of a one of the areas I fall into.
So then you'll have to enter it in both, because if it's an SAH, it is a.
It's a stroke instead of a trauma. So I was just curious on if anybody else had heard what the rule was on that. And John, you worked trauma and stroke. What's your thoughts on
As
that?
far as I know, the two registries don't talk. So
Okay.
one registry is not going to know if a patient's in the other.
Yeah.
If you
Okay.
suspect a stroke, put it in the stroke registry. And you, of course, if it's trauma, you know that it has to go in the trauma registry.
Okay, I was just curious.
Good question. Interesting question. All right, guys. Well, I'm going to stay on for just a little bit.
And I think there was one question for Mary on there
I'm not
too.
trying to run everybody off.
Okay. So, can you see my screen? So, Mark, this is where you will put how you can do a report on custom fields. Right here. So it's the configurable right measured reports where you would just do anything else. But right here, this is where you can start free texting.
And
And
Mary, I've run it, but usually when I run one, like I have a physician that wanted me to kind of watch the patients who've had Watchman, and they wanted to know who all they had that came back that had Watchman that had a stroke. And so I created a custom field, but then when you go to run it, you can't. Well, I hadn't been figured out how to run it with just that field without having to put it piggyback in on something else.
Well, you can just put it by with diagnosis.
Okay.
Yeah, you're right. You can't run it just on its own, but if you put it by diagnosis, then it's going to filter it by Watchman or whatever your criteria were, and then you can just kind of ignore the differentiation between ischemic or hemorrhagic or whatever. But yeah, you're right. You do have to piggyback it onto, and I would pick diagnosis. That's the broadest measure.
Thank you.
Mary Jo, I have a question too while you're looking at those. I was trying to run a report on our telestroke visits last year, like the specific patients that had that. But when I did it, it would run that and it would show me numerator, denominator, whatever, but it wouldn't show a case list at the bottom. Was that something I was doing wrong when I was trying to run it?
You will, well, let's, was that this, were you picking something from here?
Yes, ma'am.
Just.
And I think I did aggregated data maybe for the just the entire year, I want to say. And then I feel like I picked telestroke from there and also from on the right, the standard measure. There's one option in one of those boxes that says telestroke consult or something like that. And I picked that one, but I couldn't get a case list.
Well, I can, this is a demo account, so it may be a little bit different than yours
Yeah.
specifically. But normally you should be able to see a case list. You can't see a case, well, no. Yeah, normally you should be able to see a case list. So, if you want to send me an email, then we can figure out why it's not showing,
Okay.
but it normally would do so. So. And of course it's running too slow. So, but just contact me and we'll figure it out.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you.
While you're running that, I had a stupid question.
No, there's
So,
no stupid question.
we're trying to keep, work on our door to CT times, and
Yeah.
one of the issues we have is like the people that come in by POV, we have an issue when they get triaged. Kind of watching that time, would you enter that under like the stroke team? Because there's not a really a place to put triage time. Because I mean, do you understand what I'm saying?
I think the triage time kind of counts as the arrival, doesn't it? Or do you are
Well,
you talking
no,
about
they'll
time?
arrive and then there's a triage time.
Oh,
Trying to
What are you
pinpoint
trying to use
where.
it for again, Mark? Tell
Trying to
me.
pinpoint where there's a deficit in care, because they arrive by POV and they sit in our waiting area. If they come in with stroke-like symptoms, they should be triaged immediately. So then the triage nurse is going to direct care from there. So if there's a delay from the triage to the, like we had one that had a delay, had a triage time of 4 minutes, but then to door to MD was 20 minutes. Trying to pinpoint, okay, there's the education that needs to happen this person or this department on getting that person through faster.
Are you using the time tracker? Are you
Yes.
putting data into time tracker?
I have started to use it more when I want to pinpoint. So
Yeah.
when I go in, the only thing I could think to put it under was the stroke team, because there's not really. We don't activate our like a stroke team in the ED like that. We don't record that time. So would it be best if I just put it under that triage time under the stroke team?
I think, whatever, if you think that's the best way for you to collect it, then I would say, yeah, go ahead and do that.
Okay.
But I think at some point between your whoever triages that patient to the ME, there's some education that needs to be done between it to close that gap zone. If you're trying to decrease your arrival to CT time.
Okay, thank you.
Remember too, whenever you can add a comment to any element. See right here. So if you put show comments, you get these little bubbles next to every single element. And you can do free text in there. You could say, if you wanted to just do the standard, this is not stroke team activation, this is something else. But you can't when you run a report, you can't run the comments, but nonetheless, it can be a useful tool for you internally, to keep track of stuff. So you can do free text comments on any single element. But I
If
don't
I
know
could
if that's
add
helpful.
in, Mark, I always look too closely, maybe more closely at the CT time, the door to CT, as opposed to the door to doc, because as it's a nurse-driven protocol, if they went to CT right away, that kind of shows me they did initiate that, as opposed to waiting to see the doctor and then the CT time being later than the doc time. Then I know that they waited on the doctor to initiate. Not sure if that helps, but.
Does. Thank you.
Let me
One of the
just
things
sh
that we had started doing different here at Baptist Creekman, we asked the nurses, like, what's your biggest, barrier? And it was simply a wheelchair. They didn't ever have a wheelchair handy. So when we hear, when they check in and it's anything, neuro related, they'll page, code neuro overhead, and either CT, someone from radiology, somebody will get a wheelchair and take it down there. And sometimes they may not even need us, but you'd be surprised how many times there really isn't simply just a wheelchair down there and it delays the care. And that's really helped us a lot here.
I like that idea where you're really kind of talking to the providers themselves and saying, what are you seeing? What's your barrier? Because it can be something as simple as that. So I think that's a really good example. But I would encourage you, as Marcus said, that he's using custom fields and you can run a report on it. So if there's a particular thing you want to look at, you can create a custom field. So as long as that data is in the medical record, that's being documented and you can abstract it if something really particular to you. And you can create the custom field and save it and all that kind of stuff. So I think that can be a valuable tool for individualizing the registry for whatever, it is that you're looking at.
That's a great discussion, everybody.
It's a lot of good information. Thank you all.
You bet. All right. If everybody's happy, I'm going to call us to a close. Like I said, I will be sending out an eval, hopefully this afternoon, but it might be tomorrow morning. You'll have 2 weeks to complete that and get it back to me for CME. And in that, I will do my best to include a link. For the time being, ADH has had we've changed where we host videos. So you may just get a link to my Google Drive and you can listen to this and share it with folks until I can manage to get it posted on the internet somewhere. But I will make sure that it's available. Thank you so much for attending. Thank you to our presenters. It was fantastic. I love it. And with that, I'm going to bring us to a close. If you need help registering your attendance, I'm going to stay on for a few more minutes. But otherwise, y'all have a fabulous week.
Thank you. All
Thank
right. Thank
you.
you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
I think I had one person on the telephone. And it was a number I didn't know. Are you still there? Don't know. All right.
This is the first time I've been on here.
Okay. Is that Sherry?
Sherry, yes.
Yeah, I see you on my list. I see that you've registered.
Yes.
Super.
Okay. But my email's changing Monday.
Well, let's hang on just a second. What's your new email going to be? Do you know?
S. Weisenbach at SBRMC
SBRMC.
dot org.
All right. I got you down.
All right, thank you.
You betcha.